My name is Kristin Hicks. I'm the section chief of the Plant Tissue Analysis Lab at the North Carolina Department of Agriculture Agronomic Division. For this session, we will discuss how to use plant tissue and petiole sampling in strawberry to optimize fertility. Plant tissue tests are widely used in high-value crops like strawberries to evaluate the nutrient status of the crop. In North Carolina, June-bearing strawberries are intensively managed through the production season with regular routine tissue sampling of both the leaf and the petiole. This tracking fertility begins with bloom or earlier and continues with sampling occurring every other week. Tissue tests are also used year-round to troubleshoot abnormal appearances and to differentiate between fertility and other problems like disease and unfavorable environmental conditions. Before we dive deeper into how to collect a tissue sample and to interpret a plant tissue report for strawberries, I want to take a moment to explain what the tissue test shows and what are the principles behind the interpretation. A plant tissue analysis report will show the concentrations of each nutrient that were measured in the leaves. Here's an example of a report from the NCDA lab for a strawberry sample. On it, you can see that the macro and micronutrient concentrations are reported here up at the top. On the second row are the interpretation indexes, which convert the nutrient concentration to an alphanumeric index that tells you if the nutrient level is deficient, low, sufficient, high, or excessive. To collect tissue samples for strawberry, the correct leaf to select is the most recently mature leaf with petiole, which is about the third to fifth leaf back from the growing point. This is a little difficult to differentiate in strawberry, so a good way to visualize it is that the most recently mature leaf isn't the older leaf laying down on the plastic, and it's not the one sticking up in the middle. It's the one in between those two positions. You want to collect about two handfuls of leaves in order to get a good representative sample, and you should select leaves that are healthy, of the same variety, and under the same fertility program. If you're trying to troubleshoot a problem, collect two samples, one good, i.e. healthy, and one bad, i.e. unhealthy. For most crops, tissue analysis is performed on just the leaf, but in strawberry, the petiole is also analyzed in order to track nitrate-nitrogen levels. Monitoring nitrate levels in the petiole is the best way to fine-tune in-season nitrogen feeding rates. It is best to detach the petioles in the field for more accurate nitrate readings. Separating them in the field limits the amount of potential translocation of nitrate from the petiole into the leaf blade. For tissue sampling in June-bearing strawberries, you want to begin sampling at the first week of bloom, which is characterized by the presence of about 5 to 10 open blossoms on at least 50% of the plants. Or, expressed another way, it means strawberries will be ready to pick in 4.5 to 5 weeks. Continue to sample every 2 weeks throughout the season, or about 12 weeks. Target petiole nitrate levels have been established for each week beginning with first bloom, so it is very important that you understand and accurately record on the sample submission form the correct number of weeks since the first week of bloom. Reporting the wrong week will result in receiving the wrong recommendations. Again, the first week of bloom is characterized by about 5 to 10 open blossoms on at least 50% of the plants. The first week of fruiting should be at approximately week 4, but don't start recounting the weeks at 1 when you transition to the fruiting growth stage. You want to continue on with 5, 6, 7, and so on. If the nitrate levels in the petiole are within the target range for that week, NCDA recommends that you stay at the maintenance rate of 5.25 pounds of nitrogen per acre per week. If petiole nitrate levels fall below the target, NCDA recommends that you increase your rate to 7 pounds for that week. However, these recommended rates are not universal, and we recognize that growers in some areas, such as your very sandy, leaching-prone soils, may need higher rates. Before we review some sample reports, we will first switch gears and review the most common nutrient deficiencies found in strawberry leaf tissue samples in North Carolina. This chart shows the percentage of samples that were found to be below the sufficiency level in the tissue for each nutrient, and is based on about 2,000 samples submitted to NCDA over a 3-year period. As you can see, the most fertility issues in strawberry are, in order, nitrogen, sulfur, magnesium, and boron. An additional factor that we consider is the highly important nitrogen to sulfur ratio. Nitrogen is constantly monitored in strawberry production. Over-fertilization leads to soft fruit and reduced marketable yields, and under-fertilization leads to poor growth and reduced yields. NCDA bases nitrogen recommendations for strawberry on the nitrate levels in the petiole, rather than the nitrogen levels in the leaf. That is because nitrate in the petiole is a more sensitive indicator of evolving real-time nitrogen status in the plant, and thus enables fine-tuning of nitrogen application. The leaf nitrogen is more indicative of the long-term nitrogen status of the crop. The next two slides will walk us through examples of nitrogen deficiency in the leaf tissue or the petiole or both, and what corrective action we would recommend. This first example shows a report with low tissue nitrogen but high petiole nitrate based on the week of growth. When petiole nitrate is high, we recommend lowering or halting the nitrogen feeding rate for that week because too much nitrogen can lead to vegetative growth and soft fruit. In example two, nitrogen is low in the tissue and nitrate is low in the petiole. When this occurs, we recommend increasing your nitrogen rate by 1 to 1.5 pounds of nitrogen per acre per week. The take-home message here is that while the leaf nitrogen information is useful, week-by-week nitrogen recommendations are based on the petiole nitrate levels for that week of bloom. Sulfur deficiency is the second most common nutrient deficiency in strawberry. It tends to occur in acidic soil, sandy soil, and waterlogged soils, or, very importantly, where the nitrogen to sulfur ratio is high. Strawberries are very sensitive to nitrogen-sulfur ratio. When it is out of balance, it affects the ability of the plant to utilize nitrogen. NCDA recommends sulfur application, primarily in the form of Epsom salts injected into the lines, whenever sulfur is low in the leaf or the nitrogen-to-sulfur ratio exceeds 18 to 1. Here are two examples of elevated nitrogen-to-sulfur ratio. In the first, nitrogen is sufficient, sulfur is low, and the nitrogen-to-sulfur ratio is high. In this situation, a sulfur application is clearly needed. In the second example, nitrogen and sulfur are both sufficient in the tissue, but the nitrogen to sulfur ratio is elevated. Here, we are still going to recommend a sulfur injection, even though tissue levels are adequate, because of that effect that the nitrogen to sulfur ratio has on utilization. Magnesium deficiency is the third most common deficiency in strawberry in North Carolina, and it presents as interveinal yellowing in the older leaves. These deficiencies tend to occur in sandy soil, acidic soil, and during cold, wet periods. The corrective action is an application of 10 pounds of Epsom salt per acre per week until the deficiency clears. In the example below, more than one injection will likely be needed due to the severe magnesium deficiency in the tissue. Boron deficiency in strawberry is also fairly common here in North Carolina. It results in poor fruit set and small, soft, deformed fruit. If boron is deficient, as indicated in the example report, the corrective action should be done before fruiting because adequate boron is needed for healthy flower production. When applying boron, the line between sufficient and toxic is very narrow, as we will see in the next slide. Finally, boron toxicity is almost as common in North Carolina as boron deficiency. Boron toxicity appears initially as bronzing of the leaf, as shown in the picture on the right. It then progresses to necrotic spotting around the edges and leaf curling, as shown in the picture on the far right. In this example report, the boron level is about 500 parts per million, which is roughly 10 times the sufficiency level. Boron becomes toxic in plants as concentrations approach 200 parts per million. When boron toxicity occurs, there is very little that can be done to correct it except wait and see, so be very careful with boron applications. Thank you.